Today on R&R on Sports, Larry and Howard take a look at the instability of college sports and NIL and say goodbye to a legend. That and more on this week's episode of R&R on Sports. Now, here are your hosts, Larry Robinson and Howard Robertson.
Hello and welcome to R&R on Sports. I'm Howard Robertson.
And I am the fantabulous one, Larry Robinson.
You just made up a word. Fantabulous.
Fantabulous. All right. Call me Don King today, and we're going to make up words because that's what we can do. Because every word is made up if you didn't know Uncle Howard.
Do you know Don King? Don King, I use Don King as a case study as one of the greatest of all time to ever stay on point, stay on message consistently. I don't care what Don King.
So he's a Republican?
Huh?
He's a Republican?
He was, I think.
Really?
Yeah, I think he was. I don't think he was. I'm sure he was. As a matter of fact, I think he was good friends with Donald Trump. Or maybe
I can see that.
Maybe
see
is that. Good friends with Donald Trump. Yeah. But one thing about it, he had a whole lot of stuff going on, whole lot of stuff out there about him with the mafia and all of this, and he always had some kind of court case going on. But he would not miss an opportunity to be on the Tonight Show and all other talk
Absolutely.
Shows.
Only
and
in America.
They always want to talk to him about what he got going on, and he would always never leave the message point about his next fight. This is the greatest country of all time. He'd always, I don't care what they, he was, man. He was.
Man, listen, so Don King, for many people who might not know or might not be old enough to know, was one of the greatest boxing promoters in history, in that he was a boxing promoter for Muhammad Ali, boxing promoter for all the top heavyweights fight, Mike Tyson.
Promoted the biggest fights, the biggest purses, the biggest media contracts of all.
Everything was the biggest ever. And kind of remind me of the guy Donald Trump, as you said, you know, is just a big, you know, it's going to be big, it's going to be huge, it's going to be monstrous.
Yeah. Might be questionable now. Might lack principles and be on the cutting edge of legality. But he in the house, he's doing it.
Well, listen, man, we got this getting close to the NBA Finals. What's your thoughts there?
My thoughts are,
because we got Boston, we got Boston in the finals already.
Got Boston, I believe you're gonna have absolutely gonna have Dallas.
Okay,
they're playing some serious ball, man.
Man,
Dallas is playing some serious ball, and whenever you hear this, I don't know if. If Timberwolves will still be around.
Right, right. But, well, but I got to ask.
A bigger wolf might have taken
him out. I really, really love Luka Doncic's swag. Luka got swag. Luka been around some brothers for a long time. Because I tell you, man, he got the game like in the hood. He got a game like he's playing outdoors in Chicago. He's big old butt.
With his big, thick ass.
Yeah, he just moseying on down the lane. And he ain't rushing.
He ain't rushing.
He ain't rushing for nobody. He's either going to take the step back three. He's going to make the smooth dish. I mean, I just love Luka's game. And it's not a lot of turbulence or a lot of friction with his game. His game is very mild.
And, what do you and mean if you turbulence think, of
so
friction
when I mean,
with
it's
his
like, it's
game?
It's not a lot
what
of bumping and moves. So when I think about LeBron, which I think is Luka Doncic 1.0, is that with LeBron, it's a lot of banging. It was a lot of banging. It was a lot of hitting. You know, when he's dunking hard and real. It's real animated and hard and rough.
You think Doncic ain't physical? He's physical
as
hell.
But he's not the kind of same kind of physical. It's almost like a more skilled physical. It's like he's just got this movement And then it's like he's taking a step back. Or it's not like he's got a lot of, like I said, friction. He's not doing a lot with the defense beating up on him. He's not going to the hole.
Well, he creates friction now because he talks a lot of smack.
Man, he talks a lot of smack.
Well, I'll talk about this when we come back. You're listening to R&R on Sports on the Kazukian Network. Back after this.
Calling all podcasters. The Podcast Club is a creative space for creators and innovators to share their voice and empower their messages. Come be a part of the Podcast Club. You can come join us and we will help you start your own podcast. We have all the tools you need, staff, studio, and equipment. If you want more information about the Podcast Club, go visit our website, kazukian.com/podcast-club. Kazukian!
This is a little R&R on sports tribute to the special relationship that exists between a mother and a son. This is our way of saying thank you, Mom, for Mother's Day. From two sons to all the mothers out there.
There's something special about a mother and a son.
A mother and a son.
A mother and a son. So love and cherish, cause you only get one.
You only get one.
You only get one. There's something special about a mother and a son.
A mother and a son.
A mother and a son. So love and cherish, cause you only get one.
You only get one.
You only get one.
Popeyes, pot pies, and french fries. I experienced all because of you. It's hard for me to dry my eyes. So I'll just cry and say, I love you. I love you. You are my first friend, my captain, my thorn in my side. When they define ride or die, you just coined the phrase, I ride till I die. Yeah, till I die. Check that out.
There's something special about a mother and a son.
A mother and a son.
A mother and a son. So love and cherish, cause you only get one.
You only get one.
You only get one. There's something special about a mother and a son.
A mother and a son.
A mother and a son. So love and cherish, cause you only get one.
You only get one.
You only get one.
You know, Mom, I think about you all the time. I love you so, so much. You mean the world to me. And I'm sure mothers mean the world to all their sons. So, you know, KD, why don't you tell them how we really feel?
You made us believe. You kept us off the street. Put clothes on our backs, food on the table. When you didn't eat, you made sure we ate. You went to sleep hungry. You sacrificed for us. You the real MVP.
Welcome back to R&R on Sports.
Back.
So boring. So,
well, you don't like my back.
We were talking to, that's better. We were talking about Luka.
Yeah.
And you were talking about a frictionless game. I don't necessarily agree with that.
It's not a lot of bumping and grinding. See, that's the thing.
He's bumping. He's bouncing off
bumping,
of folks.
But he's not the same.
And he can take and distribute the physicality.
Yeah, well, he's a big boy.
He's a big dude.
Yeah, so he ain't having to distribute too much.
Ain't no finesse. Ain't no. It's, you know, his whole thing is bumping and, you know, and grinding.
You get these little skinny guys at the NBA. You ain't running up on Luka too often.
No.
And so that's what I'm saying. It's a frictionless game because he's not being challenged in the same way. Because he's not afraid of the contact. And I believe the point I'm making with that is that I think Luka can play like this for a long, long time.
Yeah,
because it's not the high flying.
Yeah, so physicality.
He ain't gonna have a whole crazy knee stuff going on.
I agree with that. As long as he can get up and down the floor, ankles, and as long as he doesn't pass out from asthma or exhaustion I agree with you.
I just think he's going to be able to play that style. His stuff is skill based. Yeah,
his game is skill based. He can shoot the lights out. He can shoot from every position. Falling away, leaning over, from half court, he hit a shot from and somebody looked around. I think it was my man Edwards. Was it ever looked around and go, went, did he hit that? And then they called a foul on him. So it was a 4-point play.
Yes. But, man, I mean, I just think, Luka, we might be looking at – but can you imagine how crazy Atlanta must feel right now? They traded Luka for Trae Young.
Well, I mean, they got some good service out of Trae Young.
No, Trae Young's a great ball player. I like Trae Young. But I'm not trading Luka back then. This dude has been playing pro ball since he was 14, 15 years old.
Right.
And he's been
at this level though? Was he playing at this level then?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Luka went what did Luka crackpot team. When did he get drafted? When did Luka get drafted? Was he like 2 or 3? Yeah, he was okay. traded. He was traded.
Say
for
what
Trae
he said, because you can't hear him.
He was picked at number 3, and he was traded for Trae Young.
Okay,
which was number two. But so I'm still trying to figure out number one. How do you pick Trae Young over him, over Luka, with the comps? Look at the comps. I mean, the brother's 6'9", 6'10".
Look, man,
and then he's built. He's built like a damn tank.
Absolutely.
And so for me, it's really trying to understand how do you pick a Trae Young over Luka, and then how do you trade Luka for a dude who could play in the Willy Wonka deal.
Thank God in sports and in the music industry. You don't have to. The people who made certain decisions about certain people don't ever have to come back and try to justify the decisions that they made. Because if so, somebody would be answering that one. And
that's why they blew that thing up in Atlanta. That's why they still blowing that thing up in Atlanta.
In the music business, I happen to know somebody that we both know.
Uh-huh.
That had an opportunity to sign Earth, Wind, and Fire and passed on him.
Really?
Yes, yes. We both know this person.
Wow.
So anyway, I'll tell you about that off mic.
Okay.
But let's talk about this NCAA NIL stuff.
Okay.
What I got, you know, they came out with this thing that they're going with the Power Five and all of this money, and there's still no checks and balances on the NIL, and it's still the Wild Wild West. And I think what they're going to be doing is going to have an huge negative impact on a lot of colleges and universities. And HBCUs across America. Talk to me.
Well, my thoughts more than anything is that college sports college in those revenue producing sports such as basketball and football will begin to be the semi-pro that it's always been. It's been the semi-pro for a long time. And because of that, now with the money being where it is, you got to put that first. And I think, you know, with anything else, I can go work for the small company Or I can, if I'm good enough, I can go work for the Googles and Teslas and the people like that. And I think that's what you got. I think you're going to have the entities where you have, you know, those big entities like your Power Five schools, your Ohio State, your, you know, UK and all that. That's going to be
the ones that have always had the resources.
They've got the resources, and they're going to keep the resources. And I think they're going to create
super leagues. I ain't worried about that.
I think they're going to create super leagues. I think the NCAA is going to go away. Now, I do think that because I don't think there's going to be a need. Then when you get to the under that, you're going to have the mid-tier, like the mid-tier companies. You got your Fortune 5. You got your Fortune 50. You got your Fortune 100. Then you got your Fortune 500, and then you got your Fortune 1000.
Who is going to be the entity or the individual, if there is one, to maintain any kind of regulations or decorum or protocols for all?
I think you're
going to
have
stuff.
A commissioner. I think you're going to have a commissioner, just like you have, you know, David Stern, Adam Silver, Gary Bettman. All of these commissioners, I think you're going to have a commissioner.
Do you have confidence personally that there will be equitability in this process going forward, especially with all this money?
Since when has capitalism had equity?
Okay.
I mean, this is capitalism at its finest.
Short answer, hell no.
No.
Okay.
I mean, it's gonna be the haves and the have nots, as everything is in a capitalistic society.
But for collegiate sports, that ain't all right.
Guess what? You've been watching March Madness for all of these years, all these upteen years, and you still watching it. And you're going to be watching March Madness going forward, and you're going to still be mad about the fact that the HBCUs ain't getting what you think they deserve. Because at the end of the day, the cream is going to go to where the top is, and all that other stuff is going to go to the bottom. And the cream of the school, the cream of the players are going to go to the Power Five schools where they're going to make, like this kid. What's this kid's name? Jaden Rashada. He agreed to a $13.9 million NIL deal.
At Florida?
At Florida. And, that, you know, because Florida reneged, so now he's suing him, and he's now in Georgia. So now, you know, Georgia just gave him some upteen million dollars. You know, and that's after going to Arizona State, which gave him some upteen million dollars. To play at Arizona State. Now he's at Georgia, number one school in the SEC. He's going to get paid again. And this kid, before he really gets started playing college football, is already going to be 13, 14, 15, in the teens of millions, in the good. So once again, who has the resources? So you got whole college programs that don't have $14 million to spend.
Whole entire program.
So, and ain't no HBCU. Shit, he would have taken the salary of everybody in the HBCU for the last five generations at $13.9 million.
Yeah.
I mean, so this is going to be a total different ball game. And once again, in a capitalistic society, what is that? He who has to go.
Them that's got shall get. Them that's not shall lose.
Shall sit. Them that got shall get. And them that don't will sit.
All right. We're happy that you are still with us here on R&R on Sports. We got an incredible interview for you. And
as always,
people that you won't hear anywhere else, stay tuned right after this
potluck interview.
Human Speed with Kirk Whalum.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my brother,
Jonathan Butler.
What's up, Kirk? What's up, man? I like this. Humans Being.
Humans Being with Kirk Whalum.
Kazookian.
Welcome back to R&R on Sports.
Check.
Yes.
We are back, brother. We back.
Yeah. You still trying to do the falsetto thing.
Well, you know, me and Smokey been working on it. Me and Smokey been, he's been taking me to classes and we've been doing it through Zoom.
But it's not happening.
Tears on the clock.
When are you going to stop? When are you going to quit? Just give it up.
No, he said I'm improving.
Quit lying on
Come on, man. We got a guest.
We are welcome. we are thrilled to have with us today on R&R on Sports, Mr. Phil Horton, Director of Athletic Performance, currently Pit Crew Coach for Drive for Diversity Crew Member Development. Now, we have talked a little bit about this on past shows, but first of all, welcome to R&R on Sports, Brother Horton.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Glad to have you. As we, Larry, have talked a little bit before about the NASCAR has really, really gotten into this thing where they have recruited elite athletes to become part
of. Well, hold on. Before you go there, though, I want to get into some of your background. Phil,
we're gonna get there.
Oh well, I mean, you're taking too damn long. So come on, you're taking it too long, man.
Well, I'm gonna quit. This is my last broadcast. anyway, recruiting elite athletes to become part of the pit crews. That is part of your responsibility. And yes, let's get into your background. And then we're going to work our way up to how you do what you do. So let's start. Give us a Cliff Notes version of Mr. Phil Horton's background.
Well, basically, my original background was as an athletic trainer, sports medicine. Graduated from North Carolina A&T back in 1983. Went on to become an athletic trainer. I went to grad school at Michigan State.
All right.
I was a football trainer. Got a chance to work with Nick Saban when I was assigned to his as an athletic trainer to his linebacker corps for a couple seasons, and I got a chance to watch him coach, which would come into play later on when I decided to be a coach. And and then from there, I went to become the head athletic trainer at Florida A&M.
All right.
From 1985 to 90 under the late coach Rudy Hubbard, and then later with Ken Riley, former player with Cincinnati Bengals, and then from there went to the University of Memphis for almost.
Right.
Wait. Using Memphis. Go Tigers. Using the Memphis.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I was a head football trainer. Served with Chuck Stobart when he did his stint there. Back in the early 90s, and then moved from there to be the assistant trainer and strength coach with the Milwaukee Bucks for about 5 years, and five long losing years. It wasn't the Bucks better now, but
that was during the Paul. That was Paul Pressey time, wasn't it?
It was after that. That was the Glenn Robinson, Todd Day.
Years.
Those were some feudal years right there.
Yeah. That was a tough go. But it taught me. It was a great experience. It didn't teach me enough to be able to stay in the league and become a head trainer or a strength coach in the league because, you know, we really weren't winning. And I started my own company, Athletic Training Concepts. Moved back to North Carolina, where I'm from, back to racing country. I grew up a fan of racing. My background was my father, the late Carl Horton, and my brother, Terry Horton. Terry owned his own service station. So I grew up pumping gas and wanting to be a mechanic. We were racing fans. You know, I was into two.
How did you get into racing? Phil, what attracted you to racing? Because it wasn't many of us in racing.
Well, I was a fan, like I said, from the time I was 10 years old. But of course, I went to stick and ball route into sports medicine and the strength and conditioning. But when I started my own company, Athletic Training Concepts, I got the chance to work with a race car driver by the name of Ernie Irvin. I became his personal trainer, his strength coach, and his athletic trainer. And that's how I got into racing. After I left the Bucks, started my own business, started working with him. He was one of my first, my biggest clients. And since I was a fan of the sport and knew the sport, I knew as much about him as he knew because I was a fan. And, so then I started working with the pit crew. A crew chief by the name of Ryan Pemberton asked me, you know, would I take a look at the pit stops? And being with my sports background, you know, he said, well, you know, can you help us get faster? You know, we want to be fast at these pit stops. And there were just a bunch of mechanics, you know, that wanted to be athletes and wanted to perform. So I started working with them, and this was like 1999, 2000. So okay. I realized that, you know, they really didn't know the athletic side of it. So I came up with my own philosophy, myself and a couple of more individuals, one by the name of Mike Houston. And we really brainstormed this thing and came up with our own philosophy on how to do pit stops, how to teach mechanics, how to be athletic. And of course, they got better, they got faster, and my business took off.
Okay, so.
Well, wait a minute. Hold on. Let me ask you this. And by the way, this is Iron Island Sports, and we're speaking with Phil Horton, strength and conditioning leader for Rev Racing. So I'm curious as to why would a driver need to have a trainer?
Right. Well, you know, that's always been one of the questions by the people that are not familiar with the sport. You know, you think about it. Try driving from Memphis to Charlotte, North Carolina, which is about what? Maybe what? 500 miles, maybe? Yeah.
Yeah.
About 500 try doing miles. That. Try doing that in 3.5 hours at about 190 miles an hour, man. Around 40 under drivers. Try doing that without being in shape.
You got to be in some shape. Right.
You got to be in shape because it's hard for us to drive from Memphis to Charlotte in 11 hours. It's tiresome. Right. You know,
so so you have been a trainer for multiple sports. What kind of shape do you have to be in? What's driver shape?
Great question. The cardiovascular part of it, the stamina and the upper body strength you have to actually make that all work and be able to focus. See, when your body gets tired, you can't focus. You lose mental focus. Okay, so then even though you are a great driver, but you're tired, your arms are tired, we call it falling out of the seat, you know.
Falling out of the
car itself, the cockpit inside the car is like 130 degrees. Now they have
so you hot air conditioning. You got on all this stuff.
Yeah. Right. So then you have to be and of course before they got air conditioned helmets, you had to be acclimated to the heat. Or you'd simply fall out.
Yeah. You faint.
So then the cardiovascular, being able to have the stamina to withstand the heat and to be able to concentrate, makes them in their own world an athlete. Because without it, you just pass out. The average person would literally pass out in about an hour of trying to drive a car at those speeds and dealing with the competition that they're around and what all goes with it. They would lift you out of the car in about 30, 40 minutes. You wouldn't even
back in the day before the helmets were air conditioned, were there literally wrecks because somebody just passed out driving?
Well, nobody would admit it, but I'm sure there were. But actually, you know, they drove all the time. You know, they raced two or three nights a week in this heat. They got acclimated within a week, within 2 weeks, they were acclimated to it. So they were already used to doing it. They already knew how to get in shape. They got in shape by racing. They got in shape by driving. Sometimes, you know, they would take a regular passenger car and when the season started and roll up the windows and just drive around for a couple of days, sweating in the car, you know, until they got acclimated. You know, it's kind of like football. You know, you got to practice in that heat. All the coaches
absolutely. In that
heat for a minimum of 7 days until you get used to it, so that you could be able to play the game. Same thing.
Hey, coach, what type of diet? This is the last question of this segment, but what type of diet must a driver have in order to be in peak headspace for them to be able to drive before a big race?
Well, they need those carbohydrates, you know, whatever comes with that, you know, you whichever that way that they can acquire that, you know, and each individual has their own way of doing it. But carbohydrates are big. You know, you need the water supplementation. You need to drink that water 2 days, you know, before the event. You know, you have to be hydrated. You know, you have to stay away from the alcohol, and you have to get your rest. You have to get your rest. So those, you know, and with today's diet plans and what people eat today, a lot of times that falls short because people are not eating 6-course meals anymore. You know, they're just eating right. A little bit here and a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and they call it a diet, which is not. But the body is very strong. It adapts to whatever you're doing, but you have to have the carbohydrates, you have to have the hydration, and you have to have the rest.
All right, all right. We're talking to Phil Horton, pit crew coach for Drive for Diversity Crew Rev Racing here on R&R on Sports.
But guess what we're going to talk about when we come back? His relationship with Penny Hardaway.
Okay. All right. All right. When we come back for more R&R on Sports right after this.
Looking to make your event unforgettable? Let Kudzukian handle all of your event production needs. At Kudzukian, we specialize in event production services that elevate every moment. From flawless sound to captivating visuals, we've got you covered. Make your event shine with Kudzukian. Contact us today at kudzukian.com or give us a call at 901-512-6767.
Kudzukian. Welcome back to R&R on Sports. Phil Horton is our guest, and we are finding out all that we did not know about racing and NASCAR and driver shape. He's a trainer. He's an athletic trainer and has trained for all sports. And he's given us tremendous insight on what it takes to be a great driver. And we're going to talk about pit crew.
Hold on. Is there a such thing as a fat NASCAR driver?
Yeah, there are. But especially back in the day, there was a lot of them. But they still reached a level of fitness that allowed them to drive. One of the things that is unique to a race car driver, they have a great cardiovascular system because they learn how to control their heart rate at an early age. And what it is they don't get excited, they don't get carried away when certain things happen out on the track. But when you learn to not do that, your heart rate doesn't kick in. And when your heart rate doesn't kick in, you are able to bring in the necessary oxygen that it takes to have that endurance. They can go from a race car, get on a treadmill without ever doing the treadmill.
Right.
And do very good. That's why a lot of them are marathon runners and are capable of doing that. Not so much from their athletic side of it, but from the ability to control that heart rate and bring in the oxygen that you need to keep going. It's called a Krebs cycle. It's a little
Is there a weight limit?
You know, we don't want them. You don't want to be obese. You know, there's an unwritten weight limit. Now, like in Formula One, there's definitely a weight limit. IndyCar, definitely. But in NASCAR,
and it's what?
Well, I mean, I don't know the exact numbers, but the drivers, they don't need, there's no 250 pound race car drivers, 260 okay. pounds.
You couldn't do it. Okay. You couldn't do it, brother.
You can't even fit in the seat. No,
you couldn't do it.
You can't fit in the seat. You can't fit in the seat. Kind of like you have to be a jockey. I mean,
in a manner of speaking, you are a jockey.
You are a jockey, right.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. Man, America, this back is in the day. Phil Horton of Rev Racing, the lead athletic trainer for Rev Racing, this whole diversity initiative at NASCAR, and we have him here today on R&R.
So was it your idea And if it wasn't, just go on and take credit for it, because I want to know that we're talking to the one whose idea it was originally. Was it your idea that great athletes would make great crew? Pit crew.
No, it wasn't my idea. I was in the NBA at the time that it started. It started with a racing team by the name of Hendrick Motorsports. Okay. Ray Everham.
I've heard of them, yeah.
Yeah, Ray Everham, Andy Papathanasiou. They were the first ones to start using athletes as pit crewmen. So it was not my idea. What was my idea was to basically take athletes, okay, and come up with a philosophy for athletes to do the racing. In other words, in other words, they were already bringing in athletes, okay, high school, some college athletes, to be pit crewmen. Well, what they didn't have was a philosophy for those athletes to become pit crewmen. So what I did was, being from football, being from basketball, I stripped away the athletic, the stick and ball philosophy, and came up with a racing philosophy of how to be a pit crewman. That's my contribution to the sport, because it really wasn't working. We had to come up with a template of what type of athlete is good for the positions as a pit crewman. You know, you can't have a linebacker that's a changer, because a changer position, the ones that actually change the tires, that's a finesse position. So we had to develop that. The carrier, the one that throws the tires on, they're the linebacker type. Right.
Oh my goodness.
And then of course the jack man, he has to be sort of a large fella, you know, back in the day. To be able to jack the 3,000 or so pound car.
Right.
With speed.
From the ergonomics of movement, and then also there was a way to run around the car. There's a way to get to the car, the way to get down, to get in position to do it. And just because you're an athlete, you have to learn those techniques. So we came up with like 8 fundamental techniques of how to pit a car. And we taught that, and I coached that, you know, this is how you do this to be successful at it.
What's the target time for a pit stop?
Target now is about 9 seconds.
And what happens in that 9 seconds?
Nine seconds to change four tires. And there's been like a couple of sub nines to change four tires.
And refuel the car?
Wait, hold on. You got to change four tires. What are you saying? 9 seconds to do all of that?
Yeah, well, and back when I got into it, it was about 16 seconds, and we got that down by using the ergonomics of movement and bringing in athletes. We got that down to about 13 seconds, about 12 seconds, and then we changed, and then, of course, they went from the 5 lug hits to the 1 hub, and so that shaved off another 2 seconds, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, and so that's down about 9 seconds.
That's amazing.
Man, that's absolutely amazing. Listen, this is Iron Island Sports, and we're speaking with Phil Horton of Diversity Racing, Rev Racing, and you've started a next generation of pit crew members. There's another Horton coming along. Let everybody know what he's doing.
My son, Marcus Horton, he is the tire changer for Kurt Busch, number 45, Monster Energy, Jordan brand team. They got their first win in Kansas about a month ago, and he's doing really well. Yep.
How did that make you feel when he got his first win?
Oh, that was a proud moment. That was like passing the torch, even though I didn't go over the wall as a pit crew, you know, being the coach and everything, and then bringing him into the sport and him being successful at it. That was big. That was a bucket list type of thing. Once he decided to get into it and to accomplish that. And he's won in all 3 series. He's won in the Truck Series, in the Xfinity Series, and now in the Cup Series, which is, you know,
racing in the Horton blood, man. Racing's in the blood. That's DNA.
That's beautiful. Oh, that's beautiful. Awesome. So
I was just gonna ask, like, is there any truth to, and I want to throw it back a little bit, is there any truth to the fact that individuals like Wendell Scott and other black racers, car racers, would actually win races back in the day, and they wouldn't allow them to win in front of everybody, but they would actually allow people to leave and then call them up and say, yeah, you actually won. Here's your trophy.
That happened one time in the 60s when Wendell won in Jacksonville.
Wendell Scott?
Yep, Wendell Scott won, and they knew, you know, they knew that it would be hell to pay if they announced him as the winner. So then the track promoter decided not to do that. They announced somebody else, and then they called. But Wendell knew he won it, and they called him in, afterwards after everybody left and gave him his prize money. But he didn't get the trophy till later on.
He didn't get to kiss the girl or get the milk.
You're talking about the staff and the
kiss the girl.
Yeah, he get to kiss the girl, you know. Yeah,
what you think?
You better not even look at the girl.
That's exactly right.
So yeah, that's real. That's a true story.
What look girl?
Look it up. Look at the, you know, yeah. That's a true. NASCAR has since presented him with a trophy last year, his family and family members, and tried to, you know, write and, you know.
They just rectified that last year?
Yeah. Rectified it last year, yeah. Yeah.
So, as my grandma would say, just between us chickens, how, in your opinion, is the diversity, the whole diversity push going in NASCAR, particularly given the culture of NASCAR previously? What do you right. see?
What so, do you see? So based on what I'm getting ready to tell you, you know, the culture and what people perceived and how people felt about it was real. What Wendell went through was real. What the other black drivers went through, Randy Bethea, some of the other ones that came, Willie T. Ribbs, that was real. You know, I'm from the South. I grew up in a small town, Lenoir, North Carolina. You know, and I know racism firsthand, and you know what you hear is pretty true. You know, those things occurred. Those things happened. What Absolutely. Has transpired? What is trans? And so NASCAR was then and still is a microcosm of the South. You know, right. it's a microcosm of the racism that goes on in this country in any industry. You know, I mean, the NBA has it, the NFL has it. You know, even though the athletes are predominantly black, you know, the front office isn't. You know, and there's a glass ceiling, you know, for athletes, for administrators, for pit crewmen. Yeah, I mean, all of that still exists. That is real, and that's what's going on in the country. It still continues, you know, and we still have a long way to go with that.
Yeah. And what's your role in changing that narrative in NASCAR?
So when I got into the sport, coming from the NBA, coming in as an athletic trainer, I was like a individual that basically pulled a thorn out of individuals' paws, right? I helped them get better. They got hurt. Mm-hmm. I came up with solutions on them to get them better. I was in healthcare. I was a trainer, right? And so I wasn't a threat. So when I got into it, you know, I was welcomed, you know, especially coming from the NBA. Now, when I got into the coaching part of it, you know, I was placed in a position to actually lead individuals, you know, that were not used to being led by an African American. So then things begin to change, you know, and you could see some of the resentment, you could see some of the attitudes and things change because my role changed. You know, at a one time, I was the only African American in a competition role on pit road. There's a photograph that I like to show that shows that because somebody took a picture of the entire sport lined up for the national anthem and I'm the only one. And that's not because anybody was trying to keep us out. We were not trying to get into it. We're still not trying to break down the door, you know, because of the perception, you know, but But after I'd been in the sport for, 6 or 7 years, there was a push. There was a push, a gentleman by the name of Max Siegel. Came to the sport as the president of DEI, Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. And he was the first African-American to be a president of a major race.
Max has been on the show. Out of Indianapolis, Max has done a lot of things.
Exactly right. And of course, he's the CEO of USA Track and Field now. And he owns Rev. He owns Rev Racing. And he told me once he came into the sport, he said, "Hey, I'm really him and Reggie White, the former Green Bay Packer, great.
He used to be Reggie's agent.
Reggie was a big racing fan, and so he and Max came up with the idea of diversifying the sport. And since I was already in it, about 7 years into it, Max tabbed me to be the director of athletic performance. Because of my background in it and all the teams that I'd worked with, I'd done work with all the big teams, the driver Dale Jarrett, Juan Pablo Montoya, Sterling Moreland, Todd Bodine, just to name a few. So I knew the sport. And so once I took over the program and as far as from the pit crew and of course, training the drivers, that initiative was to really increase minorities, introduce it to minorities, take it to minorities, take it to blacks, take it to women, take it to Hispanics, anybody that wanted to be in it. Our job was to make it, to create an avenue for them to actually do that. And that's what we've done over the last 15 years.
Phil, if a young man is listening to this show and he really wants to try to get his foot in the door in NASCAR, what would you recommend?
Well, first of all, we would definitely like them to be a fan of the sport. A lot of people want to come into the sport because of the money that's in the sport now, you know, because our say a athlete wants to continue his athletic ways of his athletic career, you know, but you have to have a love for the sport. You have to like racing. You have to like cars, you know, and that's one prerequisite, but not everybody that's in it. They come in it for the money to continue their athletic careers, and they learn to love it. But it is an acquired taste, you know, and so they would basically call me up, you know, they would say, "Coach Horton, I'd like to, I'm thinking about, wanting to be a pit crewman, you know, and call me up. I like phone calls, you know, I get the emails, I tell them to call me, you know, I get the texts, call me." So it's really, just call me. You know,
just go to Rev Racing. Go to Rev Racing and look up Phil Horton. He's there on the website, and connect with him if you are interested in learning more about being.
We will have a one-on-one talk. I'll lay it all out for him and show him the way. Maybe it is the way. Maybe it's not. You know, but we've had about 120 people come into the program. About 75 have actually lasted and made it and found a career in the sport. There are currently 55 individuals in the program now, and there's about 32 on the major level. And we generate about $2.5 million in salary for those pit crewmen throughout the sport. So that's like a minimum of 60 to 70,000 and a high of about 175.
We
like to think of ourselves as one of the most progressive diversity programs in the world.
Well, I like to say in Memphis, Tennessee, from all indications of these knuckleheads driving around the interstate with these souped up guys, I know a lot of them that think that they could be race car drivers and would be safer. Everybody would be safer if they were on a track.
Right. Well, now the driving program is a little different. It's just like football and basketball. You need to start. You don't have to, but you need to start in a young age. And definitely before you're 15 years old. And for all the ones that are 21 and 22, it's a little too late for them.
Too late.
Unless they got a whole lot of money. It's still, you can buy your way into the sport in any form of racing. But for you to be successful, you really have to start early in life to actually make that happen.
Wow.
And the costs are tremendous. We have a young driver by the name of Roger Carruth now of course, that is really coming through the ranks and is doing really well. He started out in iRacing, and we have brought him through the late model program. He's in the ARCA series now. You need to look him up. He's the next Bubba Wallace. You know, Bubba Wallace is in there now. But he's the next Bubba Wallace, and we're looking for big things from him.
All right. Well, listen, we got one thing before he left. He has a connection with Memphis, Tennessee. And Phil, can you just share with everybody your connection with Memphis and your connection to Penny Hardaway?
Well, at the time I was the head football trainer at Memphis State, as it was then. And I got a call in the middle of the night that unfortunately Penny had been shot, you know, shot in the foot. And so once we got all that straightened out and everything, I had the chance to actually work with him in his rehab, and I got to know him really well. And then I subsequently left and went on to Milwaukee, and I used to send Penny back some Milwaukee Bucks gear and stuff. And then when he, of course, made it with Orlando, we stayed in contact, and now that's pretty much how it went. You know,
that's awesome. A lot of folks don't know that story about Penny.
And well, of course, he overcame
hanging out with the wrong cats. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. And of course, he's doing great.
Absolutely.
I follow the University of Memphis, and I'm very proud of what he has done.
Right.
Fantastic.
Right.
Well, Phil,
thank you for being here with us on R&R on Sports. We appreciate you. We appreciate the perspective, man. I mean, because this is very, very unique. And stick around. We're going to be back to you.
Yeah,
I hope to have you on future shows, because we want to start keeping closer track of NASCAR and what's happening in the sport.
And when you want to come to a race, you just let me know. We'll get you in the garage area.
Hey.
All right. We're gonna do R&R from North Carolina.
With cars whizzing by.
Racing's a great game. NASCAR is doing a very good job. We have a long way to go. We haven't reached the finish line yet, but we're definitely on the right path. Things are going
well. All right. And we will be back for more R&R on Sports right after this.
Blues in the Basement.
The blues come so many different ways. I'm telling you, it's kind of hard to explain.
Everybody wants to know why I sing the blues.
Now, I'll tell you about the blues. Now, blues dwell with you every day and everywhere. But whenever that you get a sad feeling, you can tell the whole round world you got nothing but the blues.
First you take my heart in the palm of your hands and you squeeze.
Blues in the Basement on the Kadzookian Network.
Kadzookian.
All right. Back for more before we head to the door. So,
what you got, man?
Well, I know hail and farewell.
Yeah.
Hail and farewell to a nemesis at the time back in college. Who single-handedly prevented Memphis State University from winning their very first national championship in almost anything, but especially basketball. 1973, I was 1,000 miles away from home watching a 12-inch black and white TV with aluminum foil secured around the antenna, which had to lean up against the window to really get the reception in a room full of people. But I'm talking about Bill Walton. Bill Walton,
throw it down, big man.
Hey, man, he had a tremendous career at UCLA. Went on to be a Celtic. And
No. Let me tell you when I experienced Bill Walton.
Okay.
I'm watching a game at my cousin's house, Louisville, Kentucky, on Ormsby Street. Watching the game. Game six, maybe. I'm watching
Finals?
Yeah.
Okay.
Dr. J is my guy.
Uh-huh.
So Dr. J, Andrew, Tony, all the guys,
y'all gonna win a championship. Doc gonna win a championship. Cause see, my relationship with Dr. J started in the ABA when he was playing for New Jersey mm-hmm. Nets. Mm-hmm. Used to come and play against the Kentucky mm-hmm. Colonels. Mm-hmm. Watching this dude. Man, but this big, tall, white guy, redhead, that's doing all kind of crazy stuff. Mm-hmm. Passes. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's got no look stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, and then he had the enforcer, the brother, Maurice, what was his name? Godly, it's escaping me right now. Maurice Lucas. Yeah.
Ain't that big.
Yeah, but he was an enforcer. Oh, yeah. He was an enforcer of Bill Walton.
Okay.
But nevertheless, man, so Bill Walton brings the championship to Portland Trailblazers. Broke my heart.
Yeah.
And I was like, who is this dude? Yeah. This dude is so good. I ain't never heard of him.
And he played big. Man. He was a center, but I think he was one of the pioneers of the whole power forward. Uh-huh. Position because okay. he was mobile. And he could shoot,
he could pass.
Yeah.
He played a well all around mm-hmm. game. Mm-hmm. But I mean just amazing the fact he came out of the UCLA mm-hmm. and everything else. And then the next thing we saw, he was in Boston where mm-hmm. he ended his career. But he got him another championship. He brought up the rear. But nevertheless, he got him two championships and became an icon
yeah.
of the NBA.
Yeah, he and Reggie Miller were tight.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, Reggie Miller UCLA. Was getting a little verklempt.
UCLA, yeah. man. Yeah. You know, that's UCLA, right. That's UCLA right. fraternity. But, that's man, right. so sending out tall timber to the Walton Bill family. Walton.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And, man, Godspeed, brother.
We appreciate you being with us here on R&R on Sports. And as usual, talk about us. Tune in again, always. But especially talk about us and tell for others to check it out. No other sports show like it. You take care of yourselves. Take care of each other. I'm Howard.
And I'm the great one, Larry.
Peace.
See you.
You've been listening to a little R&R on Sports, written and produced by Howard Robertson, Larry Robinson, recorded and mixed in Memphis, Tennessee. Don't love all this stuff.